السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Inshallah, for the purposes of barakah and reflection, I'll start off with a recitation from the Noble Quran. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هل أتاك حديث الغاشية وجوه يومئذ خاشعة عاملة ناصبة تصلى نارا حامية تسقى من عين آنية ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع وجوه يومئذ ناعمة لسعيها راضية في جنة عالية لا تسمع فيها لاغية فيها عين جارية فيها سرر مرفوعة وأكواب موضوعة ونمارق مصفوفة وزرابي مبثوثة أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت وإلى السماء كيف رفعت وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت فذكر إنما أنت مذكر لست عليهم بمسيطر إلا من تولى وكفر فيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر إن إلينا إيابهم ثم إن علينا حسابهم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. As always we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. O slaves of Allah, first and foremost, I begin by advising myself and then all of you all who are present here to adopt a life of taqwa. For that is the ultimate goal that we have been sent to this earth for. To adopt a life of taqwa, to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during every single second of our lives. Allah Himself says in the Noble Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our powerful maker, He says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I have not created mankind or jinkind for any other purpose other than worship, ibadah, other than the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He Himself, Azza wa Jal, He says in another place in the Noble Quran, Ya ayyuhan nasu a'budu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum walladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqoon. O mankind, u'budu rabbakum, worship your Lord, alladhi khalaqakum walladhina min qablikum, the one who created you all and those before you, la'allakum tattaqoon. Worship your Lord so that you will become people of taqwa, so that you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so that you be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we wish to attain success in this world as well as the hereafter, it is upon us to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during every single second of our lives. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. And secondly, it is incumbent upon all of us to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the numerous bounties and favors that He has conferred upon us. Allahu Akbar. As He Himself says in the Noble Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. That if you were to try and enumerate the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you were to try and count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَا تُحْصُوهَا. You will not be able to encompass all of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We would fail miserably to try and encompass all of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And personally, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I thank Him profusely for this beautiful opportunity where Allah the Almighty has blessed me to visit the beautiful coral islands of the Maldives and to meet all of you all for no other reason other than the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So at the very outset of this gathering, I wish to express that I love all of you all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He, the Almighty, makes this evening and the following few days that we are going to spend together, insha'Allah, a source of benefit for all of us in this world as well as the hereafter. And then as our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, that the person who does not thank mankind, the one who does not thank the people, has not thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, in accordance to the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I thank the organizers of this event and I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them and give them the best of this world and the hereafter. So, before we delve into this evening's topic, I wish to share with you all a beautiful hadith. A hadith that I hope will inspire all of you all. This hadith is recorded in Muslim. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ مِّن بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ بَيْنَهُمْ. No gathering gathers together in one of the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and studying it amongst themselves, illa nazalat alayhim as-sakina wa ghashiyatuhum ar-rahma wa haffatuhum al-mala'ika wa dhakarahum Allahu fi man 'indah. Allahu akbar. Look at the virtue Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed gatherings of this nature. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that except that sakina will start to descend on that gathering, the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will envelop that gathering, and the malaika, the angels, will shroud and surround that gathering. And Allah the Almighty mentions those people who are involved in that gathering amongst those who are with Him, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty talks about that gathering with the malaika. Allahu Akbar. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this gathering a gathering where the sakina descends upon us and the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala envelops us and the malaika shroud us with their wings, and may Allah the Almighty make high mention of us in the seven heavens. So my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, we move on to the topic of this evening. The topic is the hands that rocked your cradle. The hands that rocked your cradle. We will be touching on another great blessing. As we said in the beginning, the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are numerous. So this topic, inshallah ta'ala, the content around this topic, we will be touching on another great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the numerous blessings that He has favored us with. That is our parents. We will be talking about our parents. We will be talking about the responsibilities each and every one of us we have towards our parents. The rights of our parents upon us. My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is indeed a blessed ummah. The ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a blessed ummah, as we are constantly moving from one virtue to another virtue, from one mercy to another mercy. Allahu Akbar. We keep moving in ranks. Allah the Almighty, He created the creation. He created everything that you can see around you. He created all of the creation, and then He subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave virtue and superiority to some of His creation over others in a manner that befits His glory. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيَخْتَارُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Lord, He creates whatever He wills and chooses. And they, the creation, did not have the luxury of that choice. He creates whatever He wishes and He chooses from them whatever He wishes. Exalted is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and high above what they associate with Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from all of that. For if we were to take the seven heavens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created all of the seven heavens, and then virtue was given to the seventh heaven, the reason being due to the proximity of the seventh heaven to the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The seventh heaven is the closest to the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the arsh upon which Allah the Almighty, our powerful Maker, ascended upon in a manner that befits His majesty and glory. Allahu Akbar. Allah the Almighty created the Malaika. He created the angels, and virtue was given to Jibreel. Virtue was given to Mikael. Virtue was given to Israfil alayhi salatu wasalam. Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam is the archangel. He was known as Aminul Wahi. He was the one who brought down wahi to the messengers, to the Rusul alayhi salatu wasalam. Mikael alayhi salatu wasalam, from amongst all of the angels, he was given the responsibility of provisions and rains. Israfil alayhi salatu wasalam was given the responsibility of the trumpet. And according to the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he, Israfil alayhi salatu wasalam, has already placed the trumpet on his lips, and he is waiting for the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to blow the trumpet, to commence the day of Qiyamah. Allah the Almighty, He created paradise. He created the Jannat and gave virtue to Jannatul Firdaus, which is the highest of paradise. Allah the Almighty created mankind. He created Nas, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave virtue to the prophets alayhimu salatu wasalam. Allah the Almighty, from the prophets, He gave virtue to the Rusul. We're talking about the Anbiya, and from them Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave virtue to the Rusul. And from the Rusul, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave virtue to Ulul Azm. From the Anbiya and the Rusul alayhimu salatu wasalam. And they are, number one, they are five in number, the Ulul Azm. Number one, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Number two, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Number three, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And from the Ulul Azm, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave virtue to two of them, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, by giving them the title Khalil, Allahu Akbar, the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from these two great friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Almighty gave virtue To our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may my mother, my father and myself be ransomed for him. Allah the Almighty made him the best of prophets and made him the best of mankind. And we are from the ummah of that great Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are all from the virtues of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My beloved Shaykh, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, he reports from one of our Salafun al-Salih, he says that if you want to know how great the virtue of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon you, just close your eyes for a few moments. Just close your eyes for a few moments. What happens when you close your eyes? Everything around you becomes dark. The minute you close your eyes, everything around you becomes dark. Then you understand the virtue of the eyesight that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you with. Without it, you will not be able to walk in front of you. Everything is going to be pitch dark. So many blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are swimming in an ocean of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our lives are permeated, basically saturated in the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So great is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from these numerous blessings, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, comes about the valuable blessing of our parents. Our powerful maker, Azza wa Jal, he says in the noble Quran,
وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا وَاخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا.
And your Lord has decreed that you worship none other than Him, and that you be excellent, that you be excellent to your parents. If one of them or both of them attain old age in your life, do not say to them, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ. Do not say the word أُفْ, that is a word of disrespect, nor shout at them, but address them in terms of honor, address them with kind words, and lower unto them the wing of submission and humility through mercy, and say, رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. My Lord, bestow on them your mercy as they did bring me up when I was young. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us in the noble Quran. Now let's look at a few highlights of the ayah. Number one, Allah the Almighty has brought the command, treat your parents well. Treat your parents with excellent, right after the command of ibadah. Allahu Akbar. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. He has brought the command, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then right after that, what is the command? Give out zakah, fast Ramadan, make hajj. Nay, treat your parents with excellence. Allahu Akbar. Right after the command of ibadah, treat your parents with excellence. In Surah Luqman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرُ.
And we have enjoined upon man care for his parents. His mother carried him weakness upon weakness, wahnan ala wahn, and his weaning was in 2 years. Anishkur li wali walidayk. Allahu Akbar. so that he be grateful to me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this. So that he be grateful to me and to your parents. Allahu Akbar. Anishkur li wali walidayk. So that you be grateful to me and then your parents. First the command was ibadah, and right after that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought the command of being good to your parents. Now in this ayah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then to your parents. Allahu Akbar, shukr. Look at this, all of this highlights the importance of how well we need to treat our parents. Excellence upon excellence. Now coming back to the main ayah that I recited, if they attain old age, we are not supposed to say even uff. Scholars of tafsir, Imam Mujahid, rahimahullah, he says, in regard to that, he makes tafsir. He says, even if your parents, due to their old age, even if they start to urinate on themselves, because naturally, the minute they become old, they lose control of their bladders. Even if they were to urinate on themselves, even if they were to pass stool, do not look at them with disgust. Do not say, oof. Why? Because you're supposed to do that to your parents, you're supposed to clean them up, you're supposed to look after them, because they did the very same thing for you. When you were young, you urinated on yourself. You were not able to control yourself. You passed stool. And they very lovingly, they never did it out of disgust. They never looked at you with contempt. They never looked at you with hate. Nay, they picked you up lovingly. Even if you were to pass urine 3-4 times a day, they used to pick you up lovingly, take you to the washroom and wash you, clean you, do everything with so much of love. Our parents. But when they become old, when they become like children, why do we look at them with so much of hate? Why do we look at them? Why do we screw up our faces? Why do we show disgust in when we are looking after our parents? Imam Mujahid rahimahullah says, you're not even supposed to show the slightest change in your face when it comes to the service of your parents. But sadly, many of us, we remain oblivious to the fact that we have to treat our parents well when they have attained old age. Many of our parents, when I look at the gathering, if our parents are alive, they're obviously going to be of an old age. We are supposed to look after them in a treatment that is up to par, excellence upon excellence. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anh, he says that three ayat are tied with three things. Ayah number one, Ati'ullaha wa ati'ur rasul. Ati'ullaha wa ati'ur rasul. You're supposed to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obey the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you were to only obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your obedience to Allah the Almighty will not count. These three things go hand in hand. Three ayat. Atiyu Allah wa atiyu Rasul. If you only obey the messenger and not obey Allah, that also will not count. That's ayah number one. Ayah number two, wa aqimu salata wa atu zakah. Establish your salah and give out your zakah. If you were to only establish salah and not give out zakah, your salah also will not be valid. It will not be counted. You're supposed to do, but all these things go hand in hand. Ayah number three, anishkur li wali walidayk. Be thankful to me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this, and then be thankful to your parents. If you're only thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you haven't spoken to your mom or your dad for the past 10 years or the past 15 years or for the past 10-5 months, that thankfulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not count. Because all of these things go hand in hand. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu mentions this. For if we were to act the opposite of what I'm saying, birrul walidain, if we were to not show good treatment unto our parents, that would be regarded as uququl walidain, where we have shown disrespect unto our parents. And Allah save us all, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam. Uququl walidain is from the evil signs of the day of Qiyamah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us part of an evil sign of the day of Qiyamah. There's a famous hadith known as Hadith Jibreel. Time does not permit me to go into the length of the hadith, a beautiful hadith. But I'll just come to the point that I wish to highlight. In that hadith, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. I'll just give you the synopsis of the hadith. Okay, it goes along the lines of these words. And he asks, he goes in the guise of a human being. He goes in the guise of a human being and asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam questions. He asks him questions in a way that the answers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam will be as a lesson for the whole ummah at large. He goes and asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِسْلَامِ, tell me about Islam. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam answers, teaching us what Islam is, the five pillars of Islam. Then فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِيمَانِ, tell me about Iman. And then he teaches us the six articles of faith. And then he says, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِحْسَانِ. And then the next question is, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ السَّاعَةِ, tell me about the last hour, the day of judgment. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he had identified that this man who has come is none other than Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. He replies a very beautiful and eloquent reply. Mal mas'ulu anha bi a'lama min as-sa'il. He says that the one who is being questioned, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, knows no better than the questioner. You and I are on the same level. I don't know when the day of Qiyamah will take place, nor do you know when the day of Qiyamah will take place. That is knowledge reserved for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only Allah the Almighty knows that. Then Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam says, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنْ أَمَارَاتِهَا. So tell me about the signs of the day of Qiyamah. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam teaches us, and this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had taught Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this one statement, and that is the point, that is the shahid why I brought this hadith. That is the point which I wish to highlight. أَن تَلِدَ الْأَمَةُ رَبَّتَهَا أَوْ رَبَّهَا فِي رِوَايَةٍ أُخْرَى. That a slave girl will give birth to her mistress, in another narration to her master. Now this statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, many scholars gave different interpretations. The direct translation to that statement is that a slave girl will give birth to her mistress, in another narration, to her master. So some scholars, they explained that statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam as being that now we don't have slavery these days, so it's not applicable anymore. But at that time when slavery was applicable, they explained that a man who owns a slave will have a relationship with that slave. Okay? That is halal. And he will get a child from that relationship. And that child will grow up as the son of the master, the owner of the slave. Now he owns the slave who is the mother of the child. What he does, the master, he will sell the slave in the market. Now the boy grows up in the master's house. And after, say, perhaps 10 or 20 years, this slave girl, who in reality was his mother, she will go around in the market, and without his knowledge, one day he buys her. He buys her as a slave girl, but not knowing that she is his mother. This is one explanation given by the scholars. But personally, I prefer the explanation of Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, because it beautifully fits the context. Let me give you that explanation. Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he explains by saying, أَن تَلِدَ الْأَمَةُ رَبَّتَهَا. This statement indicates that towards the latter stages, towards the latter times, in other words, towards the day of Qiyamah, what will happen is, tables will turn. Tables will turn. Everything will start happening topsy-turvy. In other words, children will start treating their parents like slaves. Towards the day of Qiyamah, children will start treating their parents like slaves. They'll start ordering their parents around. They'll start putting their parents in old age homes. They'll disregard the likes and the wishes of their parents. And do we not see this happening today in our times? And if we want to save ourselves, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, we have to stay away from it completely, or else Allah save us all, we become an evil sign of the day of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. The hadith of the three Ameens. The narration goes along the lines of these words. Once Rasulullah ﷺ gathered the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. This narration is mentioned in Sahih al-Targhib. He climbs the minbar, the pulpit. Rasulullah ﷺ climbs the pulpit. Okay? And the first step, he says Ameen. The second step, he says Ameen. The third step, he says Ameen. The Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they were observing this, and then they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam later on, Ya Rasulullah, you did something strange, something that you don't do usually. At each step you said Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. What happened, Ya Rasulullah? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then explains, Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam, he came, and he made three du'as. He made three invocations. And I said Ameen to each of these invocations. But we need to understand who is making the dua. Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Ameenul Wahi, the greatest of the angels, archangel, who is pure. Jibreel, an angel. He is making the dua. And who is sealing the dua off? Not you and I. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the greatest prophet, he is sealing the dua with Ameen. So just imagine how powerful these du'as must be. Du'a number one. Destruction be to the one who attains the blessed month of Ramadan and lets it pass by without gaining the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. Ramadan is just around the corner. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said Ameen to it. He stamped the du'a with Ameen. Du'a number two. Destruction be to the one in whose lifetime his parents or either one of them reaches old age and through failure to serve them, he is not allowed to enter Jannah. Because he disrespected his parents, he is not allowed to enter Jannah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ameen. Allah say Rasulullah. The third dua, destruction be to the one whom, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam is making this dua, destruction be to the one whom, when your name, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, when your name is mentioned, he does not make salawat. Please remember salawat whenever I mention the beautiful name of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam said Ameen to that too. Allahu Akbar. This hadith has been classed sahih by Imam al-Albani rahimahullah. So it is upon us to take extreme precaution and care when we are dealing with our parents. I would like to share with you a story. A story which has a moral to it. Even though its authenticity can be debated, but it's worthwhile mentioning because there are morals to be derived from the story. There was once a young boy who had a mother. His father had passed away. He only had a mother. A mother who had only one eye. A mother who had only one eye. This mother was struggling to make ends meet because she had no husband. She was all alone. She used to go around cleaning houses. She used to go around doing odd jobs and trying to make ends meet. Now this boy, he's a young boy. So he used to go to school, come back and things like that. So he looked at his mother with only one eye. He always felt this embarrassment and he used to look at his mother as if she was an ugly person. He always had that feeling in him. One day he was in school and his mother came to the school to give him his food which he had forgotten at home. She came out of worry because she loved her son so much. She came to the school in anxiety, in worry because he hadn't taken the food and gone. She came to the school and she was by the playground trying to signal to her son. The minute the son saw the mother standing there and all of his friends also saw, he came running to his mother and said, "Get out, go away, you are embarrassing me. Go away, I don't want you to come to school." And he chased his mother away from the school. The next day when he went to school, his friends started taunting him, started teasing him. "Oh, the son of the one-eyed lady." They started taunting him like this. This made him angry. He went home that evening and he started screaming at his mother. "You old hag,
Why did you come to school? Why did you have to embarrass me in front of all of my friends? Why were you even born with just one eye? He started asking so many questions. His mother just kept quiet the whole time. He was so angry, he just went up to his room and he fell asleep. That night, he didn't have dinner. He got up, he was thirsty. He wanted to go down and have a drink of water. He goes to the kitchen late in the night and he sees his mother quietly weeping away, crying with just one eye. She was crying. He sees that and then he hates her even more because he feels so depressed. He feels sick of his life. He feels like, why was I born like this? I just want an out of this situation. And he determines that he wants to leave home. He studies hard, he gets a scholarship, and he leaves his house because he cannot bear to live with that mother of his anymore. He leaves, he goes to another country, he studies very hard, he gets good qualifications, he gets a fantastic job, and now he's working. Now this happy bubble of his is growing bigger and bigger. He marries a beautiful woman of his choice, and now he's living his life far away from his mother. He gets two children also, a son and a daughter. And he's living this happy life of his, he has completely forgotten about his mother. One fine day, an old lady walks up the porch and knocks on the door. His daughter, a small girl, she opens the door, and the minute she saw an old lady in the doorway with just one eye, she screams and she runs out of fear. He comes running down to see what is wrong and he sees his mother. He goes up to her and says, "How dare you come here and disturb my life again? I left you because you were such an embarrassment. How dare you come and scare my daughter? Why have you come here?" He shouts at his mother. His mother very quietly says, "I think I have got the wrong address," and she turns and she leaves. He is happy. "Oh, the old lady has forgotten me. She said wrong address, so that means she has forgotten me. I have nothing to worry about." And he forgets her, he goes back. After a few months, he gets a letter from his village asking him to come for a reunion in his school. He decides to go. He thinks he wants to meet his old friends and things like that. He goes for the reunion, finishes off with the reunion, and out of curiosity, he just wants to go and see his home. And you know, what situation is the old shack, the old hut in? Let me go, just go pass by the hut. He's passing by the hut and he sees that the roof has fallen. It looks very bad. And out of curiosity, not because he wanted to meet his mother, he just goes and knocks the door. An unknown lady opens the door. And then he asks her, "Where is the old lady of this house?" The lady with the one eye. That lady said, "She passed away a few months ago. And she donated this house to an orphanage." But, and then he says, "Oh, is that the case? I am her son." He says that. Then this lady says, "Okay, because she has given me a letter to give her son whenever he comes, and this is that letter," and she gives the letter to this young man. Now he takes the letter once again out of curiosity. He opens the letter, he's like, "Okay, this old hut she has given to the orphanage, it's her house anyway." He opens the letter to read the letter, and then he starts reading. "My dear son, if you are reading this, I am no longer alive. The last visit I paid you just shattered me to pieces. I am sorry that I only have one eye. I am sorry that I scared your daughter. And I am sorry that I was an embarrassment for you throughout your life. You see, when you were little," now she starts telling the story. "You see, when you were little, you got into an accident and you lost one eye. As a mother, I couldn't stand watching you have to grow up with just only one eye. So I gave you one of my own eyes. I gave you one of my own eyes. There was a transplant done and I gave you one of my own eyes. I was so proud of my son who was seeing a whole new world for me in my place with that eye of mine. I was never upset at you for anything that you did or you said. The couple of times that you were angry with me, I thought to myself, it's because he loves me. It's because he loves me. I missed the times when you were still young and around me. I miss you so much. I love you, you mean the world to me. The boy just sat down there. It's too late. His mother had passed away. And now everything comes rushing. He could not contain himself. He just breaks into tears. Why? Because it's too late. Now he wants to go and thank his mother. He thought of his mother as an embarrassment, but that eye was given to him. And that, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, all of our parents do that for us. They sacrifice everything for us. You and I, we are what we are today because of the sacrifices our parents made for us. Wallahi, I tell you, we who have lost our parents, the ones who have lost their parents, if you were to ask them, if you had a chance to go and dig up the grave of your mother and father and bring them back alive, they would say, Wallahi, I would do that. I would go and hug and kiss my mom and my dad and I would ask them their forgiveness. Then how lucky should we consider us who have our parents with us? But sadly, for small petty issues, we have cut ties with them. I tell you, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, if your parents are abroad or you're working elsewhere, do not hesitate. Don't think, okay, the next vacation when I go, I'll patch up things. No, make the call right now. They might leave before you or you might leave. None of us can guarantee when Malakul Maut is going to come visit us. Patch up things, apologize and patch up things, make things up, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam. Because this is how important our parents are to us. Hadith is in Mustadrak al-Hakim. Abi Bakr radiyallahu anhu qal, Sami'tu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul, Kullu dhunubi yuakhiru Allah ma sha'a minha ila yawm al-qiyamah. You take any sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will delay the repercussions or the punishments of that sin until the day of Qiyamah. The narration goes along the lines of these words. Illa uquq al-walidain. Except for disrespect or unkind treatment to one's parents. Except for that. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يُعَجِّلُهُ لِصَاحِبِهِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ قَبْلَ الْمَمَاتِ. Allahu Akbar. Allah the Almighty will bring the repercussions of that sin, the disrespect that an individual shows to his parents, the unkind treatment that he shows to his parents, the repercussions, the punishment of that sin will have to be faced in this world, قبل الممات, before death. Allahu Akbar. This is how serious it is, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam. Another hadith is in Bukhari. A man goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam asking him permission to take part in jihad. He asked him permission to take part in jihad. Allahu Akbar. What a great amal, jihad. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks the man, Ahayyun walidak? Are your two parents alive? And the man replies in the affirmative. He says, yes, they are alive. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed that man, Fafihima fajahid. Then go and strive, exert yourself in the service of your parents. Allahu Akbar. Even over jihad. And then comes about the mention of this amazing individual. And I'll wrap up after I mention his story. This man was an amazing man. May Allah be pleased with him. He lived at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he was not a sahabi. He lived at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he was not a sahabi. His name was Uwais al-Qarani. Uwais al-Qarani. Al-Qarani. He lived at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he was not a sahabi because he never met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have spoken highly of him and praised him. He grew up in Yemen. He was afflicted with leprosy. He grew up in Yemen, he was afflicted with leprosy. And at the same time when he was afflicted with leprosy, his father died when he was very young. And he had to look after his mother all by himself. He prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah should cure him of his leprosy except for the size of a dirham on his shoulder. He asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to leave the size of a dirham on his shoulder. Why? What was the reason? Because he wanted to look at that and remember the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon him, that each time he looks at that dirham sized piece of leprosy, he would remember the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah cured him completely. Each time he looked at it, he would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at what an amazing dua. His mother went blind and he remained in her service completely after that, because she went blind and she was finding it very difficult to get about with her daily chores. He was in her service completely. One night, there wasn't oil in the house to light up the lamps and everything was pitch dark. And Uwais Al-Qarani was finding it difficult to get around his house because everything was pitch dark. Like the statement of Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, when you close your eyes, you can't see anything. Everything was pitch dark. So he was trying to find his way around the house, he could not find it. But then amazingly, he sees his mother walking around everywhere beautifully. Why? Because she had got accustomed to the layout of the house, and because she was always blind, it didn't really matter if there was a lamp lit up or not. Because she had got accustomed to the layout of the house, she was getting along and he was amazed at that. He was amazed, he was thinking, even without eyesight, there is someone who guides her, because he hadn't embraced Islam as yet. The next morning, coincidentally, the next morning, ambassadors of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam come to Yemen. A delegation sent by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes to Yemen and they started calling people to Islam. And he goes and sees this delegation. At that point and at that moment, the delegation recited this ayah in Surah An-Nur. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجْعَلِ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُورًا فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ نُورٍ. The minute he heard the ayah which is translated, and he to whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not granted light, for him there is no light at all. The minute he heard this ayah, he realized that it was Allah the Almighty who had shown his mother, given light to his mother's eyesight, that she could get around the house, but he could not. He immediately embraces Islam. Allahu Akbar. But because he was in the service of his mother, he did not go to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was in the service of his mother. This hadith is in Muslim. Umar ibn al-Khattabi radiyallahu anhu, he is narrating the hadith. إِذَا أَتَى Or he is mentioned in the hadith. إِذَا أَتَى عَلَيْهِ أَمْدَادُ أَهْلِ الْيَمَنِ سَأَلَهُمْ أَفِيكُمْ أُوَيْسْ بْنَ عَامِرٍ أَفِيكُمْ أُوَيْسْ بْنَ عَامِرٍ. Umar radiyallahu anhu, Allahu Akbar, Amir al-Mu'mineen, during his khilafah, whenever a delegation used to come from Yemen, Umar radiyallahu anhu used to go and meet the delegation and ask, is Uwais ibn Amir amongst y'all? Uwais ibn Amir is Uwais al-Qarani. Is Uwais al-Qarani from amongst y'all? Is Uwais al-Qarani amongst y'all? Every single delegation, Umar radiyallahu anhu. Allahu Akbar. Hatta ata ala Uwais. Until one fine day he met Uwais. And then he asks him, Anta Uwais ibn Amir? Umar radiyallahu anhu is asking him, are you Uwais ibn Amir? To which Uwais ibn Amir says, yes, I am. Qala, then he asked him, Min Murad, are you from Murad? He says, yes, I'm from Murad. And are you from Qaran then? Yes, I'm from Qaran. Murad and Qaran are the names of two tribes. He is from the sub-tribe of Murad, which is of the main tribe, Qaran. And that's why he's known as Uwais al-Qarani. Yeah? And then he asked him, and you had leprosy? You were afflicted with leprosy? To which he says, yes. And then all you have got remaining is the size of a dirham on your shoulder? To which he says, yes. And then Umar radiallahu anhu asks him, and you have a mother? You have a mother? To which he says, yes, I do have a mother. And then Umar radiallahu anhu says, قَالَ سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ. And then he says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said, Allahu Akbar, no wonder. He says, our beloved Prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said, Ya'ti alaykum Uwais ibn Amir ma'a amdadi ahli al-Yaman min Murad thumma min Qaran. Uwais ibn Amir from the delegations of the people of Yemen, who is from Murad, who is from Qaran, will come. Kana bihi baras. He was afflicted with leprosy. فَبَرَأَ مِنْهُ إِلَّا مَوْضِعَ دِرْهَمٍ. Now of course this knowledge was taught to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is narrating this to us. فَبَرَأَ مِنْهُ إِلَّا مَوْضِعَ دِرْهَمٍ. And he was cured from the leprosy except for the place of one dirham. لَهُ وَالِدَ. He has a mother. هُوَ بِهَا بَرٌ لَوْ أَقْسَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ لَأَبَرَّ. Allahu Akbar. And he treats her with excellence. If he were to swear upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Almighty will accept his dua, in other words. Allah the Almighty will accept his dua. He is a mustajabu da'wa. If he were to make dua, Allah the Almighty will accept his dua. فَإِنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ. If you are able to ask him to seek forgiveness for you, then do so. And this is why Umar radiallahu anhu was struggling so much to meet Uwais ibn Amir. And then when he met him, he said, please ask forgiveness for me, make dua for me. And then Uwais ibn Amir made dua for Umar radiallahu anhu. And then Umar radiallahu anhu asks him, Aina Turid, where are you going? Or where are you headed? To which he said, Kufa, I'm headed to Kufa. Then Umar radiallahu anhu asks him, do you want me to write to the governor of Kufa, you know, to give you good treatment when you go there? Uwais ibn Amir replies, أَكُونُ فِي غَبْرَاءِ النَّاسِ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ. I wish to be from the normal people. I don't need this. In other words, I don't need VIP treatment. You know, I don't need first class, business class. Let me just be from the normal people. Allahu Akbar. Look at the piety. And the reason being, how did he become a person whose invocations are answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Subhanallah, he did not even go and meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And why did he not go and meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Because he was in the service of his mother, and that resulted in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praising him and making high mention of him, and for him to become an individual whose invocations are answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how important it is for us to treat our parents with excellence. And this is why this afternoon also, I put up a status on Facebook, because after reading this one last incident which I'm going to mention to you all, I wrote that it is upon us to treat our parents with excellence upon excellence. For even if we were to do that and combine all of those efforts that we have put in treating our parents well, all of that combined together will not equal even one contraction of pain that our mothers went through when we were in their wombs. A man goes to Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, or Umar radiallahu anhu, if I'm not mistaken, and he says, I have a mother. It's mentioned in the books of Tarikh. I have a mother who is very old and she cannot walk. So I carry her, okay? I carry her and I take her out to the fields or the plains for her to relieve herself, okay? I wait till she relieves herself, and then afterwards I turn my face away out of respect for my mother, and I clean her after she has relieved herself, and I carry her back home every single day. He asks Umar radiallahu anhu, have I fulfilled my haq towards my mother? Have I fulfilled my right towards my mother? Umar radiallahu anhu replies, not even for one contraction your mother went through in her pregnancy, Allah. Not even for one contraction. And then he goes on to say, but what you're doing is good, persist in it. And why I said this was because currently you're doing all of this for your mother. You're carrying her every single day, waiting for her to expire, waiting for her to pass away and relieve you of this burden. But on the other hand, your mother did the very same thing. She carried you, she cleaned you, she did all of that, hoping and wishing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you with a long, long life. Allahu Akbar. You saw the difference? This is how much our parents have done for us, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam. So let us become from those who treat our parents with excellence upon excellence. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. And may Allah the Almighty forgive the sins of our parents. And may Allah the Almighty accept all of our good deeds. And may He make these gatherings that we are to meet in the following days, inshallah ta'ala, a source of benefit for us in this world as well as the hereafter. And may He the Almighty unite all of us, just as how He united us here tonight in the gardens of Jannah with our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Whatever correct said was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if there was anything wrong in what I said, it is from me and from Shaitan. And I seek forgiveness from Allah.